A broken sky, traced out by the city of lights, my world from a mile high, best seat in the house tonight, touch down on the cold black top, hold on for the sudden stop, breathe in the familiar shock of confusion and chaos, and all these people going somewhere, why have I never cared? Give me your eyes for just 1 second. Give me your eyes so I can see everything that I keep missing. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, the ones that far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see. Yeah. 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 Step out on the busy street, see a girl and our eyes meet, does her best to smile at me, to hide what's underneath. There's a man just to her right, black suit and a bright red tie, too ashamed to tell his wife, he's out of work, he's buying time. And all these people going somewhere, why have I never cared? Your eyes for just 1 second. Give me your eyes so I can see everything that I keep missing. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, the ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see. Yeah. So I can see everything that I keep missing. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, the ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see. Yeah. Yeah. Give me your eyes.
Hi everyone, we're here with another Verge episode, and this week we have such a wonderful opportunity to sit down and talk with Rey Arciga. Rey, welcome to your Verge this week.
Hey everybody, hey, what's so up?
Fresh off a honeymoon, 3 weeks in Mexico.
Yes, I'm tan. I'm still recovering from the sun.
Yeah, you look tan and relaxed and loved and just, you know.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Thanks for being willing to sit down with Dana and I and tell a little bit about your story. As I've gotten to know you over the years, your story has always just touched my heart in particular. And I know that it's such a powerful story that so many of us can relate to. And so I'm just so grateful that you're willing to sit down and be vulnerable and open up your heart and life with us. We're excited. This is an exciting one for us. So we start all of these Verges just asking a little bit about your background. So if you could just share with us, what was your childhood like? What was your family like? What was that experience growing up for you? We just want to hear a little bit about your backgrounds.
Yeah, of course. So I'm born and raised in San Diego, and I come from immigrant parents, from Mexican parents. And my dad is from Michoacán. My mom is from Oaxaca. And they both came out here to San Diego, fell in love, got married. Here I am. And I am also firstborn, so I'm their first child. I was very sheltered as a kid, so everything that I did, they had like eagle eyes on me. And growing up here in San Diego, from Mexican parents, I only knew Spanish. So I grew up speaking Spanish pretty much all throughout elementary school, middle school, all I knew was Spanish. And I had to learn English, and I had to, you know, be able to communicate with friends and be able to, me being an extrovert, I always wanted to be around people and always wanted to get to know people. And so I needed to learn English. And so in school, that's what I had to deal with. And at home, my parents are both Catholic. So I was raised to be Catholic. And every Sunday we would go to church. And I didn't really know like what the reasoning was. I just knew that that's what we did in our family. We go to church every Sunday and we memorize all the prayers and we sit down whenever we're told, we kneel when we're told. But I didn't really understand why. Like, what is the purpose of all this? I know we do this once a week, but why do we do this? And I knew there was like, my parents told me, you know, there's a higher power, there's a God, but like, I never really knew or had the idea that you can have a relationship with God. And so I just did what I was told, you know, coming from a Mexican culture, it's kind of old school. You have to do whatever your parents say, like they know everything that's right. And so that's what I did. I just did everything that they told me to do. And I would follow all the rules. Like I said, I was very sheltered, so I didn't really go out. And my curiosity wasn't like a question. Like, I had to do whatever I was told the way they would want me to do it.
So being very sheltered, what was it like for you, like as you moved into middle school and high school? Because that's difficult when you're trying to figure out who you are and have your independence. But if you have and firstborns really, you know, get a little bit extra eagle eye. I get that. I'm a firstborn too. So what was that like for you as you kind of started moving into like preteen and teenage years? What was life like?
Yeah. So although I had very strict parents, mostly my dad was super strict on me. In a sense, like I feel like they also let me be who I was, because I was in sports, so I played soccer since I was 5 years old, and that's what I did, and I pretty much wore t-shirts and sweatpants all the time, and they kind of, I'm trying to think, because I also think because my parents didn't have a lot, I also had to dress in whatever clothes I found. Like, I had to wear hand-me-downs from my dad, or like I had to wear thrift store clothes, and that's what I wore. And so I wore most of the time t-shirts and sweatpants or shorts, and I was very tomboy. So they did give me the freedom to kind of like choose, even though I didn't have much of a choice, like what to wear. I chose to wear t-shirts and shorts rather than dresses. So that's one thing that, although I did have strict parents, they did allow me to wear boy clothes. They did, and they didn't judge me for it. They let me be who I was without, like, I guess you could say, judging me, which was really cool.
As you got into high school, did your sexual identity come into play at all? Were you even thinking about it at that time? Or was it just, this is who I am? And like, where does that transit? Like, how did you start having that conversation with yourself?
Yeah, which it's kind of funny because, like, honestly, because I was sheltered and because I was raised Catholic, I had no idea that girls can kiss girls and boys can kiss boys. Like, I was so, like, I guess I was raised under a rock, honestly, because until I was a senior, I think I was a senior or junior in high school, like, I had no idea. I had no idea that girls can kiss girls and boys can kiss boys. And so for all throughout that time, I thought, because I was raised Catholic and because I was sheltered and all that stuff comes together, I was like, oh, okay, if I'm Catholic, but, you know, like, girls are supposed to be attracted to boys, but I don't feel attracted to boys, so maybe I'm one of those people in the Bible that are meant to be alone forever. And so I honestly considered being a nun, like, for at that age. I was like 15, 16. I'm like, okay, I don't like boys, so here I am. I'm ready to live my life alone, I guess you could say. And I had no idea.
So, like, how did that transition into kind of your young adulthood? Because what I'm hearing is that, you know, yeah, you grew up in this family that loved you, cared for you. It didn't matter what clothes you wore or how you presented yourself, but it was a Catholic, like, your family was Catholic. There were rules. There were things that you did and did not do. And so how does that transition into young adulthood?
Yeah. So I feel like I'm trying to understand the question. Hold on. Can you ask the question again?
Yeah, so I remember when we were talking before, you said, okay, now at this certain age, my parents
need responsibility,
right? So I just wanted to see how did that transition happen, where your mom and dad were like, okay, you're 7, I don't remember when they said, but like 17 or 18, 18. Were like, okay, 18. You could go figure out your spirituality, your religion, you're free.
Yeah, so when I turned, so all throughout that time until I turned 18, my parents pretty much gave me the religious freedom to go and kind of, like, they're like, oh, you're an adult, you can go about your life the way you want to. Obviously, they're still going to be watching over me. And so they did start to let go of the rope a little bit, and they said, hey, you know, you're an adult, you can choose what you want to believe in. You know, they know I was smart enough to make my own choices, and they're like, whatever, if you want to experience another church, another religion, like, you have that freedom to be able to do that. And so I was very, like, it that really, like, changed the way I had my relationship with God. Honestly, that freedom did change my relationship.
Tell us more about how does that how did that change?
So when they gave me that freedom, I was able to meet someone who was a part of a group called Young Life, and they introduced me to this crazy group, pretty much what it was like. It was like, I was told, like, it was like a party, and I was like, okay, like, I guess I'll go to this party. You know, these kids are doing parkour, they're listening to music, and at the end of the hour, they're like singing worship music. And so I thought that was pretty interesting. I'm like, wow, you can be a normal kid where you're just like going, like, you can do whatever you want, and at the end you could be worshiping God. But I had no idea, like, that was even possible, or people can have a relationship with God. Like, I was like so shocked at that. I thought it was like God is this superpower that you can't really get to, but no, it's like God comes to where you are in your life, and you can have a relationship with God.
Yeah, it's interesting going from Catholicism to more of a evangelical experience like Young Life. So I totally get that. That makes sense.
Yeah, and it was crazy. I was blown away. I was like, whoa, this is definitely not, like, you're telling me that I can feel however I want to feel and not have to like get down on my knees to be able to have a relationship with God. You know, I can be here sitting down, you know, just talking to God. And that definitely was like a new journey for me to be able to understand that this it's okay. You can be who you are and still have a relationship with God.
Did Young Life then kind of become your church? Like that's where you kind of dove in and had all your
So pretty much I hung out with these crazy people who like loved God. I think for about like, yeah. yeah, crazy people who love God. You know, I'm always surrounded by them. and, you know, they would invite me to these retreats and groups and just activities that they would do. And because I was so like stuck in my Catholic ways, I didn't really understand like, oh, you can give your life to Christ. Like that was a big deal when I was first going to Young Life. Like, oh, have you given your life to Christ? And I'm like, I don't know what that means. Like, what do you mean give your life? Like, I don't understand. You have to sign a paper? What do you have to do, you know? And so being raised Catholic, I had to really kind of like, I guess, educate myself in the Christian community and really understand like what it is really like to have to be a Christian and to have a relationship with God. So I hung out and finally I hung out with all these people and finally after 6 months I gave my life to Christ. I dedicated it. I remember it till this day, October 9th, 2011. And when I gave my life to Christ, my friend was there and I felt like the same. Like it wasn't like this big transition thing. And I felt the same, but I knew my life was gonna change. I just felt this like heavy weight almost, but I knew I needed to figure it out. And so once that happened, my friend told the pastor of the Young Life group, right. And he like was the one that chose the leaders. And so literally that same week, once he found out that I gave my life to Christ, that I became a Christian, I guess you could say, he's like, hey, do you want to be a Young Life leader? And I'm like, I did not know what that meant. I was like, okay, sure. You know, like I honestly didn't know what I was signing myself up for.
What you didn't know is that until you gave your life to Christ, you couldn't be a leader, right?
Yes, exactly.
Got it. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so I signed up to be a Young Life leader like that next week. And I remember having to sign this big list of papers of all the rules I have to follow in order to be a Young Life leader. I'm not really sure if they did a background check or not, but I hope they did.
what you do remember about the contract was
that I was not allowed to be in a same-sex relationship. And so I remember, yeah.
By this time, had you recognized, okay, like go back, like you thought you were going to be a nun when you were 16, but now yes. You know, you're 18, 19 years old, you've now recognized, okay, I'm going to be in a relationship with a woman at some point in time.
Yeah, and at that point, I think I was fighting it myself, because at that point I understood, and what I was raised to understand was that you I guess not really raised, but I feel like it was like an unknown thing you don't talk about, like
sure.
You know, like people are made to reproduce, I guess you could say, and it was kind of like that's what people do. And so my whole life I was, that was the idea, like, oh, I'm gonna be with a man whether I want to or not,
right?
And I was like, but what if I can choose not to be with a man and I'd be alone my whole life, you know? And I was battling between, you know, the Catholic rules and then the Christian rules and then my own rules and like what I believe, like, is this really how I feel? Because I was so confused. I was young. I was like, okay, is this how I feel? Or am I just like curious? Or, but I also don't like boys. So like, what does that mean? Or like, I'm waiting for that right guy to come into my life and be like, oh, here I am, you know, here's the man you're going to marry. And I'm like, no, I can't live like my life like that. But at that time, I saw it as God is going to save me from all this. So I feel like in fear, because I didn't want to go to hell, in fear, I wanted to be saved by God so that I can somehow become straight. And that's one of the reasons I did it. But I also knew that I loved God so much that I was like willing to do whatever it took to have a relationship with God.
So you signed the contract with the hope that God will work it all out.
Yes.
And you wanted to stay in that community enough to say, you know, I'm going to trust, you know, God will fix whatever is going on.
Yeah, exactly. And because I loved the community so much, I enjoyed being around everybody. I truly knew that they were genuine people, just as long as I followed those rules, you know? And I wanted to so bad because I had these relationships, you know, with them, friendships. I had a lot of friends, and me being an extrovert the way I am, like, I enjoyed being around all those people. And I enjoyed that community.
But at some place it started to like rub, like at some spot in this transition, like your young life leader, you're going through, you know, you're like falling in love with God, you're falling in love with the community, but there's something in you that it's like, but I'm not fully myself. And at some point there becomes like you can't rectify those two things. So like, what did that look like for you?
Yeah. So it definitely was a struggle because I knew, like, deep down, I couldn't hold back my feelings. Like, I loved God and I loved being around those people. But then I started to realize that I can't hold back my feelings. And I started to like a girl in that group. And then we ended up being in a relationship, someone who was a part of the church. And I was like, how is this possible? Like, how is it that I'm trying so hard to get away from that life? And here I am in a place where I feel like I'm supposed to be saved by all this. And I'm tempted to be, confusing. Yes, it was confusing because in that time, I was feeling myself around the girl, but then I had to hide myself when we would like have to go to church together.
So you're leaving like these two lives.
Yes, I definitely was living two lives, and it sucked. Like I could never, like, it would hurt to hear anybody living like that or seeing anybody live like that. And I lived that because I lived that. And it's not a place to be, to be able to live, be yourself at some point, but hide that as well as like be yourself in another point and then hide a part of you. Like, I was hiding both of those parts because in my same-sex relationship, I could be myself, but then I couldn't talk about God. And then when I would go to church, I could love God and be a part of the community, but I can't talk about my girlfriend. Yeah. So I was definitely being pulled both ways.
Yeah. So then you decided to break with Young Life, or you needed to do something else at that point. And what did you move to?
Yeah. So after a couple years, I left Young Life because I just felt almost disgusted with myself because I couldn't be myself. Yeah. Like, I wanted to be myself. It wasn't that I was in a same-sex relationship because I loved my girlfriend at the time and I loved God. I just, I just, at that point, I couldn't deal with the pressure of accepting both into my life. And so I needed to figure out one first, and then at the same time, you know, deal with or have a relationship with God on my own without the community. So I needed to get away. And it didn't obviously end up working out with that girl. And I'm thankful for that now, because I was able to then focus on my relationship with God. And at that point is when I started to accept myself for who I am and understand that God loves me and made me who I am, and accepts me.
And so do you find another, how do you do that? Because you now you've left this community and you've emphasized, like, this was your community. One, it had to be so heavy for you to have to do this, right? And I can't even imagine, and you leave this community, and the strength and the courage that you had. And now, where do you go? Like, how do you continue to build that relationship with God?
Yeah, it was tough. I ended up going to bigger churches so that I could be anonymous. I didn't have to have relationships with the community, like friendships or relationships within the community. I could just go to church, listen to the pastor, and then take in what I needed to take in, and then go about, you know, my life. And that's what I did for, like, I want to say 3 years. I would go to church by myself, or one of my other friends who was in the same in the same journey in her life. She was the same, where we're both masculine women, and it's obvious that, you know, we get stared at in the bathroom, in the women's bathroom in public, because we are more masculine. At a glance, you know, oh, you're in the wrong bathroom. No, we're not. Or like stuff like that. And so we kind of related to each other in that way, and we were able to go to church. So I had one friend that kind of I was able to communicate with and express my feelings. But other than that, it was just me and God and these mega churches where I would go to and be anonymous and not have to like say my name unless the pastor is like, hey, go introduce yourself to someone, you know, like other than that, it was like, that was it.
So I hear you saying that, you know, you went from Young Life where you were kind of had two different like lives, you were living two different lives, but even in the marriage, you're still kind of living in this two different spaces. At church, you were like anonymous, you didn't have community, you weren't making friends. And then out in the real world, I remember you saying this once at 701, that it was harder for you to tell people you were a Christian than you were gay. And so out in the real world, outside of the church world, you really couldn't live openly as a Christian. And so you're still kind of living in these two different places. So can you tell us, like, how did you really round the corner on that? I think people would be really interested to know.
Yeah, it's funny you say that, because it's true. When I would go to like a gay bar, it was very, you don't talk about God there, because it's a touchy topic to people. And especially if you're wanting to meet someone and you want to date them, it's like that's almost like the last thing you want to talk about, because if not, you'll push people away or turn people off. And I took the leap of faith. And when I started talking to my now wife, I took that step on our second day. I asked her to go to church with me, and it was terrifying. I didn't know how she felt about the church. I didn't know what religion she was, but I knew that I wanted to pursue her and see. It's crazy to think that on the first day you see someone, you know, you want to marry. But I truly believe, like, I'm like, if I'm going to end up marrying someone, because I date to marry, this is a big part of my life. I want to see, does she accept this part of my life? And so I took that leap of faith, and she surprisingly said yes, even though she knew nothing about the Christian church. She was also raised Catholic, raised Mexican, so she kind of had this similar background. So I'm thinking when I asked her that, she's like, okay, are we going to go to like a Catholic church, or what are we going to do, what are people going to say, you know, all these things. But hey, it worked out. But at that time, I was so terrified because I didn't know how to share both of my life, like both of my lives that I was living separate and combined. It was the first time I ever combined them, and thankfully it worked out, but I was so scared to do that. And as we're dating, as we're like, I think a year in the dating, into dating, me and her continued to get more serious, and we would go to this mega church, obviously to be anonymous. And then she was now living what I had been living for the past 3 years. And we would go to church, not really say hi to anybody, but we together would start to gain this relationship with God and understand, you know, okay, how does God feel about our relationship? How do we be the best we can be in the eyes of God? And like, we obviously didn't know, like, is this what God wants? Is this not what God wants? But we were willing to risk it, honestly. Because we loved each other so much, we knew that it felt right to be together, and it felt right to have a relationship together and then with God. But I think for both of us, in the back of our heads, we're like, you know, maybe we'll be wrong at the end of the day, but we're just crossing our fingers and hoping that when that day comes, that God would forgive us for what we thought was a sin, you know. And so that we lived that for probably I want to say like a year before we obviously came and met Chelsea, and then we were introduced to 701, and then now the table. I remember, because we were talking about, okay, are we going to move in together? Are we going to get married? What is our life going to look like? And we were scared because God was a big part of our lives, and we didn't know whether we could get married or not, because again, we were having to juggle both of these things in our lives. Like, we want to be married, but we don't just want to, have like a civil marriage. We want to have a religious marriage and have a celebration. And it sucks because of COVID now, but you know, that wasn't possible, but there will be one of those. But that, I think that same month when we were having those conversations, we really prayed, and we're like, okay, God, like, we want to get married. We would pray together, and like, where can we find a church, and where is this possible? You know, I think we knew somewhere in like the West Hollywood there was churches, right? Or when you go to Pride, you see that one church that supports you, but it's like, where are those churches, you know? And so we had no idea until someone invited us to 701, which was also barely starting. Like, we started it in what, March 2019?
Gosh, yeah.
Okay, so one of you have to, let's tell our audience what 701 is.
So 701 is an LGBT group who a bunch of us young adults get together, and we talk about God. Like, honestly, that's the simplest way to put it. It's like, we get together, we share our experiences, you know, how we've been hurt by the church, how, you know, we can overcome all of that. You know, some of us are where I was, you know, 3 years ago, struggling, figuring out, okay, can I be myself and also love God? You know, some of us are, know that we can combine those two, and then it just different walks of faith within the LGBT community. Like, you think a lot of, there's a lot of LGBT folks that do love God and do have a relationship with God, and we have to do it individually, because there's still that break that from the church and the relationship with God. You know, like, it's one thing to have a relationship with God, and there's one thing to have a community, and it's, and like, what we want is to be able to do both, you know. And I think that is what 701 is. You get to combine both of those and have a relationship with God, and also be able to go hang out with people that are in the same boat with you, you know.
It's the place where you don't have to be only bring part of yourself. And that's like the table too. Like, you bring your whole self, knowing that God created you as you are. And we're trying to do this faith thing together, because it's not easy to be in the world and be Christian and be, you know, but to bring your whole self and to grow in your relationship with God and other people, to not have to do it alone in silos. And
God, you know, God created us to be together. And just what you were talking about before was so overwhelming for me, is that you had this love and such a beautiful love between the two of you, and you wanted God so much a part of that. I just hope you and Eric, like, that love is there, and God wants to be in that. And it's just, I'm thankful that you're here. I am so thankful that you're a part of our community.
Yeah, right. You're such a joy to be around. You always have such a positive spirit. And I think that you having to go through some of those struggles and really work out some of that stuff. And now look where you are now, and what a great example you are for the rest of the people that are struggling, that you really can have all of it. You can really bring your whole self and not have to shy away from God or from a community, that there's all of it there for you. And you're newly married and part of a church and doing both, and your wife knows you're a Christian and your church knows you're a lesbian. So it's yep. You're both there.
You know? Yes, yes. That yeah. is seriously, if I could write what's a movie that I would, like, you know how sometimes movies, it's like, oh, that would be nice one day, but literally, like, I'm living that movie where it's like the finished product is like, oh my gosh, that's almost impossible. I honestly didn't think that I would live the day where I can go into a church and be known for who I am. Like, literally, I feel going into the table, or like, obviously not right now, but like going into the table, I feel naked, but in a good way. Like, I feel like everybody, you guys see me for who I am, and you guys still accept me, you know? A lot of people are, you know, right now it's like, you don't want to take your clothes off because you see me, you know, but I'm like, I get to be seen, and I'm okay with that. And I'm loved and I'm accepted. And like, I could, you know, jump in a pool right now from excitement, because I never thought I would live to be able to experience this. Mm.
Beautiful.
It's not just the joy that you have, but you are a joy. Like, you bring such you're such a gift to our community. And I know that this that people are listening to, wherever they're listening to, is such a gift and such a blessing. Because you're such a great example of that. So thank you for spending the afternoon with us and opening your heart and life and just being so open and vulnerable today and always, really, right? It's such a joy.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. It has been wonderful to hear your story and your faith journey.
Thank you guys for allowing me to be able to share my story.
I'm not a stranger to the door. Hide away, they say, 'cause we don't want your broken parts. I've learned to be ashamed of all my scars. Run away, they say, no one will love you as you are. But won't let them break me down to dust. I know that there's a place for us or we are glorious. When the sharpest words wanna cut me down, gonna send a flood, gonna drown them out. I am brave, I am bruised, I am who I'm meant to be. This is me. Look out, cause here I come. And I'm marching on to the beat I drew. I'm not scared to be seen. I make no apologies. This is me. Today I won't let the shame sink in. We are bursting through the barricades and reaching for the sun. We are warriors, and that's what we become. Won't let them break me down to dust. I know that there's a place for us, for we are glorious. When the sharpest words wanna cut me down, gonna send a flood, gonna drown now. I am brave, I am bruised, I am who I'm meant to be. This is me. Look out, cause here I come. And I'm marching on to the beat I drew. I'm not scared to be seen. I make no apologies. This is me. This is brave, this is bruised, this is who I'm meant to be. This is me. Look out, cause here I come. And I'm marching on to the beat I drum. I'm not scared to be seen. I make no apologies. This is me. Scared to be seen. I make no apologies. This is me.